So, welcome back to New Hampshire. And
nice to be back.
Yeah, I have fifth trip already.
Yes.
And you are the first declared, and so far still the only declared Democratic candidate, and maybe the only candidate, because I don't know if the president's actually declared yet.
Right.
Congressman, what, just start by talking to me a little bit about what went into your decision to take the step from the U.S. House third term to running for president.
Well, last year at this time, we didn't think we would be doing this, right? Because it was my opinion that Secretary Clinton was going to be the president,
right,
and that I would be working with her in some capacity and hoping to make her administration very successful. After the election of last year in November, you know, it really made me start thinking about things differently. And so we made the decision to do this in the spring of the past year. And you know, we've been at it hard ever since. I mean, what I think the country really needs, I think the central question facing the United States of America in 2020 will be, how do we bring a fractured or divided nation back together? And I think that's a real focus of my campaign and will be a real focus of my presidency, which is trying to bring this country back together, because we've allowed ourselves to get terribly divided. Terribly divided. It's dividing communities, it's even dividing families. And I think it really puts Americans' resiliency really in question. And it's prevented us from doing things we need to do to prepare our country. Our country's changed dramatically over the last several decades based on changes that are occurring around the world. And it's going to continue to change based on technological innovation and things that are really changing our economy. And our government's really failed to respond to the change and do the things it needed to do to prepare our citizens for it. And I think right now in government, there's very little focus on the future and how the world is changing and the things we need to do. It's entirely about relitigating the past. Mm-hmm. So those are the things my campaign is about. It's about a focus on the future, right? Someone has to run for president that's really talking about how the world's changing and what we need to do to prepare our citizens for it, and also to be the person who can bring us together. I think hyper-partisan politics has destroyed this country, and we need to get back to working together, talking about the things we agree with each other on, and getting things done for the American people.
And one thing history shows is that despite the names in the last election, one can start at the very local grassroots,
yes,
level and rise to become president, thanks to Iowa and obviously,
exactly,
to New Hampshire. I've read that there are certain footsteps along those lines that you wouldn't mind following, and that being an unnamed or a little-known Georgia governor way,
right,
back when, and perhaps even Bill Clinton, who, when he first,
yeah,
got here, was not very well-known at all.
No, I mean, that's the unique role that New Hampshire plays, and your kind of partner, if you will, in this endeavor,
sure,
Iowa plays. And, you know, I appreciate the role even more now that I'm doing it, because if we didn't have Iowa and New Hampshire doing what you do, which is basically to vet candidates on a very personal and local level, which really makes a lot of sense in many ways, because you kind of get to know the candidates. There's that famous joke, I don't know if it was from Iowa or New Hampshire, where they asked someone, how do you feel about John Kerry? And her answer was, well, I don't really have a strong opinion yet because I've only met him four times. You know, and it really underscores what goes on in these states, which, mm-hmm, is local politics, small meetings, coffees at people's homes.
Mm-hmm.
And if we didn't have that, really the national media would pick the president,
right?
Right, because the American people would have no other way of making a decision on the candidates other than by what they read in the national media. And I'm not criticizing the national media, but they kind of live in the moment, right? Whatever's happening in the moment in Washington is what they're focused on. When in reality, what's actually happening in the world and in the rest of the country in terms of what people think is often very different than the kind of insider's political debate in Washington.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the role that New Hampshire and Iowa play is incredibly important, because otherwise we would effectively have our candidates be chosen by the national press.
Absolutely. In order to become president, you have to first win the nomination of the,
that's,
Democratic,
right,
Party. And in order to look ahead, one in some cases might want to look back. And so what I'd ask you, in terms of the Democratic Party, what went wrong in 2016 in your view? And what does the party have to do? And is it doing what it needs to do now to change so that someone like yourself or a Democrat can have a united party before you have a united country, or as you're having a united country.
So I think two things happened in 2016. With the now, the scale of the losses in the Democratic Party have been significant. Obviously, in 2016, we lost the White House, and we didn't win back the House or the Senate, so we've effectively lost control of federal government. But if you go down to the next level, at the governor's levels and at the state legislature's levels, we've really gotten wiped out across the last 10 years. So the Democratic Party clearly has a problem, and in my judgment, it's a turnaround. I don't think it's about our values or the things we stand for, but it's about the way we're actually talking to the American people. I think too much we talk to the American people about what we care about, whatever happens to be kind of the hot issue in Washington, or issues that the activists really care about. When in reality, most Americans aren't that engaged in the political process. That's unfortunate. I wish more Americans were engaged in the political process, and we have to do something about that. We actually get back to basic civics. But most Americans care about their job, their pay, and the opportunity for their children. And I think every time the Democratic Party is not talking about those issues is a missed opportunity. Because at the end of the day, we have to be the party that actually cares about workers, cares about the economy, makes sure people have jobs, that their pay goes up, and that their kids have opportunity. Right now in this country, 60% of the young people in the United States of America live in a county where there's no evidence of any kind of upward economic mobility. And so in many ways, almost two-thirds of the kids in this country have a very hard time living the American dream. Mm-hmm. And these are the things the Democratic Party should really be fighting for. These are the things we've always fought for. And to some extent, we've lost our way a little bit, because we care about a lot of issues, and many of them are very important, and I support them. But most of them are not issues that the American people care about. So that's one problem. What do we actually talk to people about? Are we actually focused on what's going on in their lives, or are we kind of caught up in our own kind of political portfolio of issues? The second issue in 2016 is, in many ways, we didn't really have a primary. Right? Secretary Clinton, who I supported, was effectively our candidate. Senator Sanders then got in, and it was much more competitive than people thought. But effectively, it immediately became a campaign between those two people. And I think the party's better served if there's a number of people running and we have a real debate, and no one's really anointed as the nominee before that debate occurs. Because the people deserve a real debate on the issues.
And it doesn't seem like there will be any coronation or this time at all.
And I think
because
it's going to be incredibly healthy.
Yeah.
Right, because I think we're going to have people speculate it's going to be a big number. Who knows how many it's going to be, but it's going to be more than we had last time.
Mm-hmm.
And there's not a front runner. I mean, we've actually polled in these states just to get a sense as to what voters care about.
Yeah.
And, you know, there in New Hampshire, I think, it's either 80 or 82% of the voters have no preference for 2020, and I was the same. One's 80, one's 82, I forgot. But I think the Democrats have figured out we need a real primary.
Thing.
Well, the president talked about things like infrastructure, you know, like bringing jobs back to these communities that have been left behind. That was very responsive to the concerns a lot of voters had. And those are issues the Democratic Party really has historically, you know, been the champion of. Now, I think what voters are realizing is that the president is not delivering on those promises. Right, his policy agenda in the 1 year he's been in office really has nothing to do with those promises he made to these communities that were left behind. But he did actually talk about those things during the campaign, and it resonated. I mean, for the last several decades, we've allowed huge parts of our country to be hollowed out based on globalization. And the last election was interesting because we really, in many ways, and each party did it, and Senator Sanders in particular did it on the Democratic side, and President Trump did it on the Republican side, we held up globalization as a villain. In other words, our decision to become part of a global economy was vilified in the last election. And that, to me, was a big mistake, right? Because I think we made the right decision to become part of the global economy. How could we have made any other decision? The world is becoming more interconnected. It's becoming smaller in many ways. What happens in the world economically and from a geopolitical perspective matters more to the United States of America than it ever did. So we made the right decision as a country to become part of a global economy. But where we failed the American people is by not doing anything to help the communities that we knew would be left behind. In other words, if you were sitting in the White House 30 years ago and talking about kind of trade agreements and how we want to engage internationally from an economic perspective. We should have also been talking about how, while that's the right thing to do, it'll hurt a huge number of people in our country. And what are we going to do for those people? And so what I want to make sure the debate is about this time is that the country obviously needs to respond to changes that are occurring, right? In the last several decades, it's been globalization. The next several decades, it's going to be technology. And we have to be mindful of who the winners and losers are based on these changes, and that we're doing things to help people who are left behind. And that's where we failed the last several decades. And that should have been the conversation in the last election, which is, you know, who did we leave behind and what are we going to do about them? Not was it the right decision to become part of a global economy. Of course we had to become part of a global economy.
Congressman, I got to ask you, though, given your vision here and the need to, and your view that, you know, it don't have to be a big name in order to win this time, and maybe that'll be your advantage, at least going in.
Yeah.
Out of the blue comes this Oprah Winfrey rumor, or more than a rumor. Is that kind of disheartening to you? What do you think about that?
I mean, listen, I like Oprah like a lot of the American people do. I mean, Oprah's been in people's lives in many ways for a long period of time through her show, and I applaud her what she's done in her life story. And whether she runs or not, I have no idea. My view is anyone who wants to run for president should run. And I think the bigger the field and the better the debate, then the winners will be the voters in this country, in particular the Democratic primary voters. So, you know, when you're a celebrity, like Oprah is, right, and she's a top-shelf celebrity, right, you can't find bigger celebrities than Oprah. They obviously have advantages. They have 100% name ID. And name ID is really valuable in an election. So they start with very, very significant advantages. The real question, I think, that for the Democratic primary voter is, do we want to elect someone again who has no political experience? I think that's proving to be a bit of a setback for the current president, right? And I just think I was in the private sector my whole career. I started two companies, took them public on the New York Stock Exchange. When I took my first company public on the New York Stock Exchange, I was the youngest CEO on the New York Stock Exchange. So I've had this terrific career as an entrepreneur and as a business builder, and it prepared me for a lot of things that I now, you know, do in public service. But I have to say, the almost 6 years that I've been in the Congress of the United States doing public service, learning about how our government works, I don't see how I could run for president without that experience, right? Sure, I had terrific experience being an entrepreneur and CEO of publicly traded companies and starting businesses and creating thousands of jobs. And that's very valuable in terms of my understanding of how the economy works. But to be the president of the United States, you have to understand how the government works. You have to understand how to get things done. You have to understand that Congress is really your client as it relates to domestic policy matters. And I just think there's incredibly important expertise that you really need to be a successful president. And so, you know, I just think as a country, we need to question whether we actually want someone as our president, as our commander-in-chief, who has never had any experience in public service, or who never thought public service was worthy of their time other than being the president, right? So I just, you know, I welcome everyone into the debate and into the primary, but I just think in 2020, the American people are going to be asking really hard questions about the kind of leadership we need, the kind of principled leadership we need, the kind of experience we need to really get the country on a different
track. Do you think Trump is...
So I obviously, you know, his comments last week were terrible. They shouldn't be a surprise to anyone, by the way, because he's been making comments like this across his whole kind of journey from when he decided to run for office. So they weren't a surprise to me, even though they were incredibly offensive. I think he's degrading American leadership around the world. And I think that's hurting this country tremendously. And I actually think it's putting our men and women who serve abroad, whether they be in the military or in the diplomatic corps, at some risk, by the way. You know, these kind of comments really do alienate people towards the United States of America. And it could potentially lead to people wanting some, you know, revenge on our country. And when he makes comments like that, I do worry about the people who serve our country around the world and the kind of environment he's creating and the kind of hostility and anger towards our country. So clearly the president is failing, in my judgment, as a leader. These are not the kind of comments the president of the United States makes. This is not the kind of leadership, the kind of principled leadership that we should expect from you know, the commander-in-chief of the United States Armed Forces and the leader of the free world. And it's not the kind of comments you make if you're trying to bring the country together and help establish the kind of relationships we need around the world to make our country as mm-hmm. prosperous and as safe as possible. But the other thing, I think, in terms of his running for re-election, I think fundamentally he made a lot of promises to the American people about what he would do. And it's pretty clear to me that none of them are being fulfilled, whether it be infrastructure, whether it be whether he's going to focus on the working man versus the wealthy investor, all these kind of things. He made promise after promise after promise, and really none of them have turned out to be reality in his first year in office, and I don't think that's going to change. So I, in many ways, think that's going to be a bigger issue for him, which is you're supposed to do what you say you're going to do in life, right? It's a pretty simple thing. If I say I'm going to do something, at least I'm going to try. And as best I can tell, he hasn't even tried to do the things he mm-hmm. said he was going to do.
I want to make this about you, but I just want to close the loop on him. I've read that you said he's unfit for office, but yet at this point you don't feel like, while he may have committed right. impeachable offenses, you don't feel this is the proper course, at right. least right now.
Well, I think impeachment, in many ways, there's not a definition of a clear definition right. as to what justifies impeachment. So what that means is it's really a political definition. In other words, it's the Congress of the United States determines in their judgment that someone is unfit for office based on something they did. Right? So they really define what's an impeachable offense based on what's happening in the world. So do I think his, in my opinion, violation of the Emoluments Clause, right, taking money from foreign governments through his failure to divest his hotels and those kind of things, do I think that's potentially impeachable? Absolutely. Does the fact that he fired James Comey and obstructed justice, in my opinion, is that potentially impeachable? Yes, it clearly is. But it's also pretty clear that no one in the Republican Party at all at this point thinks anything the president has done qualifies him as being unfit for office. So impeachment really only works if it's done in a bipartisan way. And the reason for that is, while impeachment, which is something that occurs in the House of Representatives, only requires a simple majority, to actually remove a president from office, you need a conviction in the U.S. Senate, which requires two-thirds of the U.S. Senate. So impeachment basically tees up a trial in the U.S. Senate that determines whether someone is going to stay in the office or not. To get a two-thirds vote in the U.S. Senate, you obviously need bipartisan support. So it seems to me impeachment is a waste of the people's time. Right? We go to Washington to do the people's business. It's a waste of the people's time to focus on impeachment unless we feel like there's bipartisan support for the president being unfit for office. So that's kind of how I think about it. So I like to use the word that it's not ripe at this point. Do I think he's done some things? Yes.
Yes.
Is there bipartisan support for this? Absolutely not. Will Robert Mueller produce something that leads us to that kind of bipartisan support? None of us know, because we have to see the results. So I generally think it's a waste of our time to be talking about it at this point, and we'd be better served fighting the bad policy things he's trying to put forth, and also putting forth our own agenda for the American people about what we're going to do for the American people instead of just talking about how bad it is. I think the way we have to think about healthcare is healthcare is a right for everyone, right? And that I think is the kind of the principle kind of high ground, if you will. I think it's the morally correct position. It's the humane position. But it's also smart for our economy. We need to get everyone in some kind of an organized healthcare system. Because right now, people can go to an emergency room even if they don't have health care, and by law, they're required to get care. So in many ways, we do let everyone get health care in this country. We just do it in the most inefficient way possible. So everyone should have health care, and there's a lot of ways to accomplish that. Continuing to expand the Affordable Care Act accomplishes that. The single-payer health care proposal accomplishes that. I have a proposal that accomplishes that that's different than the single-payer proposal. And we have to stop thinking about health care being tied to work, right? Because if it's actually a fundamental right, it shouldn't be tied to whether you work or not. And so the problem I have with these proposals around, you know, Medicaid being tied to work is I think it's kind of thinking about healthcare in entirely the wrong way. We should have a healthcare system in this country that is where your healthcare is not tied to work. So that means Medicaid shouldn't be tied to work. And similarly, the way healthcare is delivered in this country through all these employer-based plans, we need to get away from that as well, right? Because in most developed countries, healthcare is not tied to having a job. You get it as a right. You get a basic healthcare plan as a right. And then you have the ability, right, to maybe opt into better plans, just like people who have Medicare. They can buy supplemental plans. I think of a model more akin to those lines. Now, I do support other programs that are tied to work, like the Earned Income Tax Credit, which is an incredibly successful program, right, which does exactly what we should want, which is it creates incentives for people to work. But if they're working in a job that's very low paid and they're struggling, we give them a helping hand. See, that's where I think kind of the thought of encouraging people to work is smart. But I think around healthcare, I think we have to get back to this notion that healthcare is a basic right. If you conclude it's a basic right, then it doesn't really matter whether you're working or not.
Right.
You know, because free speech is something we protect in this country. It's not tied to whether you work. We don't say people who work have freedom of speech, but if they don't work, they don't have freedom of speech. That's how I think we have to think about healthcare.
How do you deal with DACA, and how do you deal with border security?
So listen, I think there's a clear bipartisan deal. And, you know, the people who are working on it, the leadership in the Senate, really have to get back to a, kind of a very simple bipartisan deal, which is DACA, you know, the people who have protected on DACA, you know, I support the proposal that's in the Dreamer bill, which basically gets rid of the temporary status for these folks and actually makes them citizens. So that should be part of the deal. And then making additional investments in border security, which everyone agrees we need, you know, good border security, and there's things we can do that are smart in terms of spending more money. That's a pretty obvious bipartisan deal.
But no wall.
You know, I think the wall's a waste of money. I think we have a better way of spending money. But if you were to tell me the only way I could achieve citizenship for these 800,000 people who are worried right now that they're going to get deported, right, is to allow the president to spend a little money on something that doesn't do anything, but I don't think it hurts anyone, it's just a waste of money, I could see how we could get to a deal there.
All right.
Right, because I really want to take care of these people. You know, and I'm fine because there is some smart thing we need to do, or some smart ways to spend money around border security. And if some of that money is wasted on a wall, the wall's not going to hurt anyone, right? It's just a waste of money. Like if someone gave you the wall for free, you'd take it probably. You know what I mean? That's kind of how I think about it.
I view it
as a waste of money, not something that harms people. Mm. There are some ways people spend money that I think actually harm people.
Right.
You know, if the president were to say, I want to create a deportation squad, there's no way I would give money to that, right? Because that actually hurts people. But the wall is a waste of money and a waste of our precious taxpayer resources, but it's not like it kind of hurts any human beings once it's up.
Finally, I do have to touch on North Korea.
Sure. President. Well, so listen, I think direct talks are fine, right? I think when you have the kind of situation and crisis we have right now, we should be doing everything we can from a diplomatic perspective to actually resolve the crisis, and if that means the president is engaging in direct negotiations, I don't see anything wrong with that. I think the president's approach, there are kind of two things. I think his administration has done some good work around sanctions, right? We have, in fact, increased the sanctions against North Korea. We have a lot more to go to really put in place the kind of truly and utterly debilitating sanctions that bring someone to the table. Right, and so they haven't gone far enough, particularly with China, but they have made progress within the UN in terms of bolstering the sanction regime. So, you know, under the category of giving credit where credit is due, I think that has been successful. I think it would be much more successful if the president didn't behave the way he has personally. Right, so I think to some extent there's kind of a tale of two approaches to North Korea. You have the Jim Mattis, right, and Nikki Haley, let's work through the UN and build additional sanctions approach, and I think they deserve some credit there. Then you have the president's approach, which is to taunt and poke, you know, and belittle and kind of make a situation inherently more dangerous through dangerous rhetoric. I think that's been terrible, right? I think that's been terrible. I think the other thing the president did, which was a mistake, was one of the first things he did when he came into office is he tore up the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, which was the trade agreement that would have made the United States the head of an 11-nation bloc in Asia that would have controlled 40% of the Asian economy. And a lot of people like to say we should put more pressure on China to actually put pressure on North Korea to de-escalate their nuclear program. Well, it's very hard for the United States to put pressure on China economically when we hand them Asia on a silver platter, which is what we did when we tore up the TPP. No one was happier, no one was happier that the United States tore up the Trans-Pacific Trade Agreement than China. Because what they did as soon as we tore up that agreement is they went to all 11 countries, they're doing this as we speak, and they're negotiating bilateral trade agreements with those countries. They're taking their One Belt, One Road policy, which is basically to create economic ties using infrastructure and other means with these countries, and they're strengthening their position in the Asia-Pacific region. And it makes it very hard for the United States to actually put economic pressure on China to deal with North Korea when we've done that. So I give them high marks for sanctions, even though it needs to go further. I give him very low marks for how he's handled the situation kind of from a leadership perspective. And I give him very low marks on decisions he's made with respect to the United States kind of economic footprint in the Asia-Pacific region.
Okay.
The one thing I'm really pleased about is people seem really engaged to talk about the 2020 election. They know it's early, but they also know that we really have to focus on the next chapter based on the failed leadership we obviously are seeing out.